As you see from the board here, we have 2 weeks without colloquia. No colloquia for the holiday next week. And then in 2 weeks' time, we have no colloquium because we have the Oppenheimer lecture. So everybody's invited to the Oppenheimer lecture in 2 weeks' time. It's a great pleasure to introduce our speaker, Mina Arvanitaki. Mina is no stranger to the Bay Area. She was a student at Stanford, and she was a postdoc in our own group here in theoretical physics. In 2014, she went to the Perimeter Institute for Theoretical Physics in Ontario, Canada. And recently, she's been awarded a prestigious Aristarchus professorship there. And even more recently, in fact, just a few months ago, she won a New Horizons Prize of the Breakthrough Institute. So we're delighted to have her visit so soon after that. Mina's very well known for her innovative and creative ideas in connecting fundamental aspects of particle physics to new observational ideas for actually pinning things down experimentally. One of her older papers on this is now quite famous, the so-called string axiverse. The idea is that in string theory, there may be many axions, and that you may be able to detect these variety of axions for example, in the cosmic microwave background, or from gravity waves from rapidly rotating black holes. Today she's not going to talk about that, I don't think, but she's going to talk a little bit. She's going to talk also about various ideas, new ideas for connecting the fundamental particle physics to how we can actually do new and different experiments in the lab. Thanks very much, Mina.
Thanks for the great introduction. See you.
Give you a bigger picture about what I'm going to be talking about. So when one thinks about particle physics, the first thing that comes to mind, of course, is big scale experiments, colliders, the Large Hadron Collider. And that's rightfully so, because in fact, for the past 50 years, we've made amazing discoveries through in these machines. Every time we were building a machine of higher and higher energy, we were finding a new particle, with the latest discovery of the Higgs a few years ago, completing the standard model. But this is not the full story. If you look at the energy scales that we know of in our universe, from the biggest, let's say, length scales, from the smallest length scale, the Planck scale that we know of, to the biggest length scale, the size of the universe, you have 60 orders of magnitude. If you put the LHC on that and the standard model, you see that you only cover a small fraction of that. So there is a lot of things, a lot of energy scales left to cover. And in fact, there are many things that would fit in many places, depending on how you want to describe it in the scale, that cannot be produced at colliders, cannot be probed by colliders. One such thing is, of course, gravitational waves. And about a year and a half ago, we saw that we had the great discovery of gravitational waves, and we first observed them directly in the lab through the LIGO discovery. There is, of course, cosmic neutrinos. They interact with us too weakly to be probed in any collider machine. But if you go in theories beyond the standard model, you will see that there are many extensions that predict particles that will interact with us either too weakly or they're too heavy to be probed at the collider. And I will talk about several examples of these type of extensions for the rest of my talk. So these roughly, so when you talk about colliders, you usually talk about the high energy frontier, pushing to higher and higher energies, probing shorter and shorter distances. These effects that I'm going to be talking about go by the name either the precision frontier or the low energy frontier. And in fact, many of these ideas have been around for quite a while. A great example of probing the precision frontier, of experiments at the precision frontier, are the searches for electric dipole moments that have been happening for more than 30 years now. But what has happened in the past 10, 15 years or so, people have come up with new ways to probe beyond the standard model physics using techniques that were developed in other fields of physics. Take, for example, atom interferometry and atomic clocks. Atomic clocks are the current standard of time and have displayed a sensitivity in one part in 10 to the 18. As I will describe, they can be used to detect gravitational radiation or they can be used to detect dark matter. There are also several other ideas, cantilever experiments, nuclear magnetic resonance. And in fact, most of these ideas, there's been a great number of ideas that have been produced in the last few years or so. So for the remainder of my talk, I'll describe several examples of these ideas. And I will describe in particular, I will focus how these ideas can be used to detect dark matter. Dark matter, as probably many of you know, you have seen this pie chart before. Dark matter is a matter component of the universe. We know because it interacts gravitationally with us, same way we interact with gravity, but it doesn't interact with light. And it's 5 times the visible matter that you see. Another very important component, of course, is dark energy. And it's the most important component of the energy budget of the universe. That's another big mystery, and it doesn't fit the usual picture that we know about. It's also what's going on. But this is something that's also important to keep in mind. So going back to dark matter, okay? So dark matter is something that people have thought about. They know it's there for a long time, since the 80s. In fact, even before they had evidence for it. The question is, the first question you ask, of course, what is it made out of? And depending on which theorist you ask, you get a different answer, because we have so many ideas of what it can be as there are theorists. In fact, if you were to put the scale of dark matter in an energy scale of mass, it would occupy a range of 90 orders of magnitude. So you have the lightest it can be is roughly 10 to the minus 22 EV. And that's because if it gets any lighter, its Compton wavelength is so large that it doesn't fit in galaxies. And the heaviest it can be is roughly 10 to the 70 EV. And then when that happens, it becomes too granular for us to fit the structure of galaxies that we see. So this is roughly a 90 order of magnitude energy range that theorists have had more than 40 years to populate with ideas. Okay. Now, the next question you ask is, how is it produced? And this is where most ideas, in fact, fail. This is the reason why, in fact, weakly interacting massive particles became very popular in the 80s. Where weakly interacting massive particle is a particle that interacts with us through the weak interaction strength, the force that's responsible for radioactivity. And if it's in thermal equilibrium in the early universe, and it has a mass similar to the mass of the Higgs, it can produce the observable abundance. And this is a very nice, this is called the Wimp miracle, it's a very nice accident. In the talk, I will be talking about another class of particles that falls in this category that has a great way of how we can produce them. A very exotic, and sometimes people like it, for example, if you take primordial black holes as dark matter candidates, actually this is where they fail miserably, because we have no good ideas of how to produce them. Now, the third question you ask, okay, we know what the dark matter candidate is, we know how to produce it, and then the question is, does it interact with us in any other way other than the force of gravity? And luckily, for the ideas that survive the first two criteria, the answer is affirmative, usually. Okay? So, now I talked about the WIMP, and what is the new category of particles that could be the dark matter and have all the nice properties that I described? One such thing is called the QCD axion. Okay, one such particle is called the QCD axion. So in the standard model, one could add, is there a pointer somewhere? Oh, it's okay. So one could write in the standard model Lagrangian a term that mixes the electric field of the strong interactions with the magnetic field of the strong interactions. And this is a CP violating term. So if that term is there, and its effects are parameterized by this theta angle that you see up there, it would produce an electric dipole moment for the neutron that we should have seen 30 years ago. Thank you. But of course, we haven't seen anything yet. Otherwise, there would have been a Nobel Prize about it. And we've only managed to constrain experimentally this theta parameter to be less than 1 part in 10 to the 10. Okay? So this has been a problem for a while. This parameter, even back in the 70s, was constrained to be smaller than 1 part in 10 to the 8. And people came up with a solution that, let's imagine now to turn this theta parameter into a dynamical field. And they called it the axion, out of a detergent brand. So as this field cosmologically evolves, the axion evolves, then it dynamically relaxes this value of theta to zero. This axion particle is actually very different from all the other standard model particles because it interacts with us very weakly and it's extremely light. It gets its mass from non-perturbative QCD corrections. So if you calculate it, you can find that it's easily has a, you can see that easily it has a Compton wavelength of 3 kilometers. This is a very extremely light particle, orders and orders of magnitude lighter than the electron and the proton. And all its properties are characterized by this axion decay constant, which if it's close now to the Planck scale, this gives you this very huge Compton wavelength. And this is, of course, as I said, this solves the, what is called the strong CP problem, and it's an excellent dark matter candidate. And in fact, some of these experiments that I'm going to be talking about probe these particles. Now, turns out that if you go to the next biggest extension of the standard model, that's very popular string theory, the axion doesn't come alone. It comes with brothers and sisters, okay? And the reason is the following, that string theory has three fundamental ingredients. One is extra dimensions, and these are required usually to make the theory mathematically consistent. Usually we're talking about 6 extra dimensions that need to be compactified to give rise to our 4-dimensional world. There are fields, there are particles that live in these extra dimensions, okay? And there is topology. And topology is nothing else but the shape of these extra dimensions, the way these extra dimensions are compactified. So you can't compactify them simply on a sphere, you can't compactify them on a torus, you can compactify them on a pretzel, or it can get even more and more complicated, and you can end up with something looking like this, which is what is called the Calabi-Yau of compactification. Now, actually, as Raphael pointed out, the different ways these extra dimensions compactified produce correspond to different laws of physics. So produce, one of the predictions of string theory is that in fact you get a plenitude of universes, that we are not alone. And I'm glad that I'm giving this talk to Berkeley because it's one of the friendlier places to say, make this statement and not being cursed. Another interesting thing, these same ingredients that this gave rise to this multiverse also give rise to a plenitude of particles that are massless or nearly massless and can appear as dark matter in many cases in experiments in our universe, okay? And there is a very nice way perhaps to explain why this happens through these ingredients. So formally, the way you say that you get this extra massless particles is because these extra particles are what they are called non-trivial gauge field configurations in the extra dimensions, okay? And what does that mean? And in fact, everyone in physics is familiar with such configurations. And it happens every time you have a solenoid and you thread through a magnetic field. Now, if you have such a configuration, let's turn it by 90 degrees, and you take an electron around this solenoid in a region where the magnetic field is zero, you will see that the electron acquires a non-trivial phase shift. So there is a physical effect, even though you're in a region of zero field, no force on the particle. Of course, if you were to be very careful in your energy budget, you find that there isn't always a region where in the lab where you have to apply a big magnetic field to get it. It's in the core of the solenoid. So there is some energy stored in the configuration that you created. What geometry does in string theory and what non-trivial topology does is it forces you, it allows you to remove the region where you would have the energy stored without losing the non-trivial field configuration. Okay? So you end up with something that is can have a physical effect but carries no energy. And as a result, no mass. So this is how these massless particles appear. And turns out, of course, that they can get small masses out of non-perturbative effects or Suzy breaking effects. But by construction, these masses are very small. So you can divide these particles in three basic categories. One of these, if these particles can appear in four-dimensional spin zero particles, scalar particles, and these are exactly the brothers of the QCD action that I talked about earlier. There can be hundreds of them, in fact. You can also get spin one particles, which are very similar to the behavior on photon. But in contrary to the photon, they have a mass, they have a very small mass. And they call them dark, some people just call them dark photons. And there is another class of particles that is correlated with the shape, that determine the shape and size of these extra dimensions. And they go by the name of moduli, the dilaton, and the radion. And these are also fields that can be naturally light and coupled to us very weakly. So all these particles are excellent dark matter candidates. Okay. So first, as I said, this slide summarizes what I just said. They are extremely light, they couple very weakly, and they are constrained by a variety of things from cosmology, the CMB, that you will see probably most of the time as grayed out regions in my plot, and I won't go into those details. So what happens if these particles are the dark matter? Okay? So now, when you usually think of the dark matter of the universe, when you think about WIMPs, for example, you usually think about little balls bouncing around trapped in the galaxy, okay? But, in fact, this is not the correct picture. What your quantum mechanics tells you that, in fact, you shouldn't be thinking about little balls, you shouldn't be thinking about little wave packets, okay? That are indeed trapped in the galaxy and move around in the galaxy. But in fact, most of the time, these two pictures are completely equivalent and you can work in either case. But something special happens as you have, if the particle is extremely light. When that happens, in order for you to keep the same energy density in dark matter, you have to increase the particle number density. So as you decrease the dark matter mass, you end up in a situation where these particles' wave packets start overlapping. So if these particles are fermions, this is a big no-no due to Pauli's exclusion principle. And in fact, Pauli's exclusion principle places a lower bound on the fermionic dark matter mass, just from that, which is around 1 kV or so, or 100 dV. Now, if it's the dark matter is a boson, this is perfectly allowed, well allowed. And when that happens, it's better not to talk about particles, but it's better to talk about dark matter as a wave. Okay? A wave that has a potential, it's very similar to that of a harmonic oscillator, where this is just m squared phi squared. You talk about the scalar field. As I said, this happens when you get more than one particle per de Broglie wavelength. And in a galaxy, this turns out it happens when the dark matter mass is lighter than roughly 1 to 10 eV. Okay? Then you can talk about a wave that has a certain amplitude proportional to the square root of the dark matter mass, to the dark matter density, and inversely proportional to the dark matter mass, and oscillates with a frequency set by the mass of the dark matter. Okay? Because this is how much energy there is available for this system. Now, when was this produced? As I said, one of the great requirements to have a good dark matter candidate, instead of saying just saying what it is, you have to say how was it produced. And turns out these particles, these very light bosons, were produced during inflation. Much earlier, this is a plot that shows the size of the universe as a function of time. WIMPs are usually produced when the universe was about 10 to the minus 10 seconds old, about a nanosecond old. So these particles are usually produced during inflation. Okay? And the way to see how they're produced by what is called the misalignment mechanism. So if you look at the equation of motion of these bosons in the early universe, what you see is that equation of motion is very similar to a harmonic oscillator. You have a frequency term that's set by the mass, and there is a friction term that's set by the Hubble constant of the universe. Okay? During inflation, Hubble, this friction term, is much larger than the mass. So much larger than the frequency, so you end up with an overdamped oscillator. And quantum fluctuations during inflation push this harmonic oscillator around, and it's very hard to pin it to its minimum. So it ends up displaced at inflation and stuck there because it's overdamped. Now, after the end of deflation, the universe cools, and why does this happen so fast? And you see now that when that happens, your oscillator becomes underdamped, so it can now start oscillating. Okay, and you see when you run the mathematics, you see now that the energy density stored in this harmonic oscillator, that's our field, scales exactly like you would expect cold dark matter to scale. Okay, so the energy density after it starts oscillating gets diluted like the scale factor cubed of the universe. Okay. Today, of course, as I said, you can still think about this particle, this field as oscillating if the mass of the dark matter is roughly lighter than 1 eV. And if you calculate what that amplitude of the oscillation is and compare it to the Planck scale, you find that it's one part roughly 10 to the 12 for a period of oscillation that's 10 to the minus 18 eV or 1,000 seconds. So this is roughly the Earth-Sun distance. Okay, this is a very extremely light particle. Now, and of course, as you see, this amplitude of oscillation is a tiny particle. So a tiny number. So the question is, how do you see this? And for the rest of the talk, I will stick about one class of particles that, as I said before, these are the moduli that determine the shape of the extra dimensions from string theory. So these, they determine the shape, they also determine the values of the fundamental constant that we measure in our universe, for example, the electron mass. Okay, so if they determine, for example, the electron mass, then they have a coupling, like of this form, to the electron that communicates the oscillation of dark matter and turns it into an oscillation of the electron mass. Okay, so how much this fractional oscillation is depends on what the coupling strength is of this particle. And as I said, this can be a very small interaction strength. If that interaction strength is gravitational, then you see that the electron mass locally would oscillate by roughly one part in 10 to the 12 for a dark matter that has a mass of 10 to the minus 18 eV, okay, or a period of 1,000 seconds, and that amplitude grows smaller as the mass of the dark matter gets heavier. So you need something, of course, this is a tiny oscillation, won't affect us in any way, not everyday lives. So the question is, how do you probe such a thing? I should say that there are already constraints, experimental constraints, because these types of particles that can be the dark matter can also modify Newton's law at large distances and violate the equivalence principle. So there is actually several experimental constraints and very stringent constraints coming from these things. But luckily, there are ways, based on new technologies that have developed in other fields of physics, that can help us detect these tiny, tiny couplings. Okay? So I will describe how you can use atomic clocks to detect this type of dark matter candidate, how you can use some old technology based on gravitational wave, for gravitational wave detection called resonant mass detectors or Weber bars. And I will talk about, at the end, I will talk about an experimental proposal called Ariadne that looks for interaction between two pieces of matter that these particle, dark matter particles can mediate. And I will also talk a bit briefly about how this can be probed by black hole physics. Okay? So, as I said, if you have this type of moduli dark matter, these and fundamental constants are oscillating. If you have an atom, then you know, because atomic energy splittings depend on fundamental constants, you know that the energy splittings in atoms will be oscillating. And you can have optical, you can look for optical splittings. You can look for hyperfine splittings, or you can look for energy levels based on nuclei that are much larger in energy. Okay, and atomic clocks are a great way to look for these tiny oscillations in the energy splittings because they're extremely sensitive. In fact, we have defined the standard of time as 9,192,631,770 oscillations of the cesium clock. And this has been, this is back in the 60s. Now atomic clocks are even more sensitive than they used to be. So if you look at your wristwatch, okay, your wristwatch by some measure loses 1 second every year. Those are the best wrist clocks, and these are, that's a pretty impressive number, 1 second per year. Now, an atomic clock, the best atomic clocks now, lose 1 second every time period of the age of the universe, every 10 billion years. Okay? So they are extremely sensitive probe. They're stable, that means they're stable, in other words, they're stable in one part in 10 to the 18. Okay? And compared to the number that I was talking to you, I was presenting benchmark numbers for the oscillation of dark matter, and I was talking about numbers of the level of 10 to the 13. So you already see that this is a great probe of such effects. So how does atomic clock work? How does an atomic clock work? So what you do in these experiments, and why they are so sensitive? So what you do is you take your favorite atomic state, your favorite atom, and you shine a laser whose frequency you tune to the transition you want to study, okay? And there are ways to change slightly the frequency of the laser by modifying the cavity size that produces the laser, till you see the atoms fluoresce. Then you know you have good resonance, okay? Now, how well can you tune the frequency of the laser on the atomic transition? So this is the fractional frequency sensitivity, delta F over F. So the first thing that determines this uncertainty, this precision, is the uncertainty principle. Every photon that's emitted from the atom has an uncertainty in energy that's set by the lifetime, okay, by the decay rate of the atom. So your first, you can only measure the frequency down to something of order the width of the atomic line. And for the, for usually for the atoms that are studied for optical transitions, these are stable in, they have lifetimes of order a second. So this ratio here is, can be bigger than one part in 10 to the 16. And this is where the huge gain in sensitivity comes from. You also gain by, your sensitivity can further be improved if you observe more than one atom at a time. okay? And that sensitivity, then the sensitivity improves like the square root of the number of atoms. And it also improves by how many times you repeat the measurement. So this is the factor of, so it improves with the square root of the duration of your experiment. And tau cycling is how long it usually takes to make one measurement, which is of order the lifetime of the atomic transition. So now, in order to detect dark matter, you have to do the following. In fact, this is the first step you have to do either way. First of all, you have to compare two different clocks at the same time. And that you do to reject systematics, okay? So you compare the frequency, you take the ratio of the frequency of two clocks every set timescale. Then, now, if there is a dark matter particle, that's a modulus and it oscillates and couples, for example, to the electron mass, it will make the ratio of the frequencies of these atomic transitions that you picked oscillate in time. Okay? So now, after you start taking the data, you start taking the data every second, for example, and you start taking the data and you continue taking for a year, and after that, you take a Fourier transform. If there is an oscillation at a specific frequency, that would appear as a peak in your Fourier transform that you do of the data. So that also tells you that this is also a broadband, what we call a broadband search. With a single device, you can look at a variety of frequencies. Okay. So what comparisons can we do? We can compare, for example, two different optical transitions, which are sensitive to variations of the fine structure constant. You can compare a hyperfine transition to an optical transition. This would be sensitive to variation of the fine structure constant, the variations of the electron mass, of the proton mass. You can also compare to the future a nuclear transition to an optical transition. And those will be sensitive to also basically every possible variation of fundamental constant caused by the dark matter. So, now, this is a plot that shows actually the first version of how sensitive this experiment, this idea is. So when we first published the paper, we were contacted by the Budger group here from Berkeley, and they told us, hey, we have this data comparing to these prosium isotopes. And the question is, can you do something with them? The data was taken over a period of 4 months, in 2 weeks chunks. They were not ordered in any particular way. Nevertheless, when actually Ken, who is here sitting in the audience, took the Fourier transform of the data, he managed to constrain in this plot, this is a dark matter candidate that couples, that makes the fine structure constant oscillate as a function of the dark matter mass. And you see here in the dark purple, you see what the dysprosium data Fourier transform gave. Already, this gray stuff is what is excluded by equivalence principle tests and searches for modification of Newton's law. And you see already that you get, by just eight data that was lying around, you get several orders improvement in reach for these searches. Since then, of course, there's a group in France that had 4-year-old data. They were taking data consistently for a period of 4 years. And they came up, they comparing a rubidium and a cesium clock, and they improved slightly this constraint here, as you see. Now, so as I said, this is what is, can be done now with just data lying around. But of course, there is a bright future ahead. This is not the end of the story. The ultimate would be to actually build a clock based on a nuclear transition. And in fact, the best candidate for this is the thorium clock. The thorium nucleus, the thorium-229, has a level splitting of 7 eV, not big MeV, which is the usual energy splitting. It's EV. And the reason is that there is an accidental cancellation between nuclear strong interaction contributions to those to that energy splitting and electromagnetic contributions. So there is a cancellation of one part in 10 to the 6. So if you were to change the fine structure constant by order 1, it would mean that that energy splitting would change by a factor of 10 to the 6. So every effect of the dark matter that can change the properties of the thorium energy splitting, the effect is amplified most of the time by a factor of 10 to the 6 or 10 to the 5. Okay? And now you see here, this is now a coupling of dark matter that couples to the quark masses relative to gravity. I should say this is a logarithmic scale. 0 is 1 times the strength of gravity, okay? And this is the dark matter mass. But you can see here also the frequency up top. So you see here that if you were to build a nuclear clock, you could improve current surges by 12 orders of magnitude. And in fact, there's a lot of room here, even with current technology, to improve on things. So now there is an even simpler way to look for this type of dark matter. Now let's go back to the case where, just to confine ourselves in the case where the dark matter candidate couples to the fine structure constant or the electron mass. When that happens, and the dark matter mass is oscillating, it means that the Bohr radius of the atom is oscillating by a tiny amount. In fact, for a single atom, this is something like 10 to the minus 30 meters, completely unobservable. But now imagine that you stack one atom next to another, like you do in a solid. Then your singular is amplified by the Avogadro number, okay, by 10 to the 23, and becomes measurable. So now if you build a detector that has vibrational modes that have the same frequency as the dark matter frequency, you can resonantly excite them. And in fact, this is a similar idea that people used to detect gravitational wave radiation back in the 60s. The first one of these tuning rods, okay, was built by Weber, and it had it could detect fractional variation of the size of the rod in one part in 10 to the 17. Today there are some experiments, one collaboration in Italy, Origa, that has cooled this bar to sub-Kelvin temperatures. And it has a sensitivity of one part in 10 to the 23. This is a 2 meter object that they can detect fractional variations of its size of 10 to the minus 23 meters. Okay? This is an amazingly sensitive machine. So if there was a dark matter candidate in the frequency range that it's sensitive at, it would resonantly excite these bars. Okay? And now, and this is a plot of what actually this class of experiments can do. This is again, as I said, coupling to the electron mass or the fine structure constant as a function of the dark matter mass. You see here what these resonant bars can do, and they can extend the search at high frequencies, because in order to see the frequency, you have to take into account that the sound speed in a solid is about 1 kilometer per second. So if you have a meter-sized object, it's sensitive to kilohertz frequencies. You make it smaller, you go to higher frequencies, and this is what you do up here. So this is a collection of current and future experiments that have been proposed. One cute thing here is this line that says Earth. So the Earth has a vibrational mode of 28 minutes that got excited, I think, in the 60s in one of big earthquake in Chile. And the seismographs around the world were measuring the decay of this mode for months. So they discovered that the Q value, the quality factor of this vibrational mode, was close to 10 to the 4. Okay? So in fact, the Earth is a pretty good tuning rod. And if you were to convert the constraint, it was sensitive to fractional variations in one part of the size of the Earth in one part in 10 to the 17. And if you were to convert in this very narrow range what it would be as a constraint of dark matter, you see that the Earth, this crappy detector, beats all experiments that we have done in the lab. And in fact, you can do the same thing with the sun. and the moon, because people look at the motion of the surface of the sun by looking at the Doppler shift of the light that's emitted from the surface. And but unfortunately, this type of strategy can only be used for setting bounds, because you don't know what can possibly excite all this more. But in principle, you can actually fill this part quite well by doing astrophysical observations. Okay. So now it's time for, before I continue to this experiment, this is where I usually take a small break and tell you a little story about Greek mythology. Okay. So I will talk about an experiment called Ariadne. Okay. You can read the acronym of what that experiment is there. So Ariadne was the daughter of King Minos of Crete in the Greek mythology. She was in charge of the labyrinth where King Minos had enclosed the illegitimate son of his wife with a bull, the Minotaur. And I think every 7 years, they would send 10 youth of Aram, from around Greece as sacrifice. So one of these times that they were supposed to send 10 youth, the son of King Aegeus from Athens came, Theseus, and Ariadne fell in love with him, and she decided to help him. So she gave him a string and a sword to kill the Minotaur and a string to find his way out of the labyrinth once he has killed the beast. So she was the brain in the entire operation, okay? So hopefully, let's hope that this experiment will be as successful as her expedition. Of course, she didn't have the best of luck because happens a lot. Theseus dumped her on their way back to Athens, somewhere in Naxos. And the most optimistic versions of the myth, God Dionysus felt sorry because he thought she was so talented, and he decided to turn her into a deity. Okay, after she passed away. So in the end, it kind of worked out for her. So okay, what does this Ariadne experiment detect? Doesn't detect the Minotaur, but it can detect interactions that these axions, string axions, or even the QCD axion can mediate in matter. So it turns out if you have an axion and you have a bunch of nucleons, the axion can source an 1 over r square field that dies off a distance of the order of the Compton wavelength of the axion away from the source mass. Okay? This is what is called a monopole field. Okay? Now, similarly, if you take a bunch of spins, these can be the nuclear spins or electron spins, and you align them, you will see that the axions can source a dipole field. A field that drops off again with a higher power of the distance, drops like 1 over r cubed, looks like this. And again, it has a finite range set by the Compton wavelength of the axion. Now, if you were to put two masses together, there's going to be a force because of this field. So in this experiment, what we look at, we take either a bunch of nucleons completely unpolarized or a bunch of nucleons polarized, and we put another spin next to them, and we look at the interaction energy between the spin and the mass and the source mass. And if you write what that coupling looks like, you see that the interaction looks like there is an anomalous magnetic field applying on the spin. The spin feels an anomalous field produced by the axion. Okay? This is not your ordinary electromagnetic field, because this axion magnetic field does not couple to the motion of charges. So if you were to put a superconducting shielding or any sort of shielding between the two, you wouldn't be able to screen this magnetic field. it also appears that it has a very different value. This magnetic field, this effective magnetic field, is 2,000 times bigger for nucleons than it is for electrons. Okay, so it appears differently for electrons and nucleons. So, given that it behaves this way, the idea we came up with is to try to detect this interaction exactly like an ordinary magnetic field through precision magnetometry. And in more particular, we looked at nuclear magnetic resonance. So in these experiments, what you do is you take a spin and you put it in a magnetic field. In that case, spin up and spin down polarizations are split by an amount set by the magnetic field. So this is what is called the Larmor frequency. Okay? So if you apply any perturbation that's tuned to this precession, to this Larmor frequency, you will cause a transition from up and down and vice versa. You will cause a resonant transition in this two-level system. Classically, quantum mechanically, this is what happens. Classically, this looks exactly like precession. So if you take a B field and you have your bunch of spins that start rotating around the applied B field, now if you go to the rotating flame and apply a small perturbation, you see that your spins, if you are a resonance, start perfectly precessing around this applied perturbation. Okay? And this is a more realistic thing of the setup. So now if you take either a polarized or unpolarized mass and there is an axion, it will source an effective field that will cause spins in your sample to precess. And if you tune the applied field where the spins are to the oscillation frequency of this mass, you will see that you get tipped off, right? The spins start processing this way. And how much off axis you are, you can pick up with the squint. The signal, how big the signal is, depends on how many spins you have and how big the coherence time of your spin sample is. What is called the T2 time for the NMR experts. And this is a more realistic version of this experiment. So instead of having a big mass blob and shaking it back and forth, what we have is a cylinder with teeth that we rotate. And instead of a sphere with spins, we fill up something that looks like an ellipsoid, a spheroid with helium-3, polarized helium-3. There is an applied magnetic field, and there is a squid pickup loop. Now, if you were to calculate how sensitive, and this is another thing that shows the same thing as before, there is an axion field, this is how the spins would process, and if you were to calculate what the sensitivity of this setup is for reasonable numbers, you find that if you integrate for 1 second, you get a sensitivity of a few times 10 to the minus 19 Tesla. If you were to compare it to the best squids now, you see that this is 3 orders of magnitude better. So in fact, by doing this type of experiment, you've also created a very sensitive magnetometer. So now these are plots that show, oh my God, this looks very strange. So this is a plot that shows how well you can probe, how big of a coupling of the axion can you probe. This is the coupling of the axion as a function of the mass, the range, the axion mass. And you see here, this is in the case where you have a polarized, an unpolarized mass interacting with the spin. This is the case of the QCD axion that I talked about earlier. You see this band here. This beige thing up here is what is excluded now by astrophysics. And this red band is what the first version of this experiment can do. The blue band, and so this is what is called Ariadne now. In the future, hopefully, we'll do this blue band, this solid blue band, by increasing the spin density, increasing the size of the sample. So this has great potential in probing deep in this QCD axion parameter space. You can also look similarly in the interaction between polarized mass for spins and helium-3, polarized helium-3. This is a spin-spin interaction or dipole-dipole. And this is when you look at the force between two nuclear spins. And this is where you look at the force between two a nuclear spin and an electron. And you see here that the first version of the experiment will be close to what the current astrophysical bounds are, but you need the future. If the future upgrades of the experiment, this is what will be interesting for the QCD axion and all sorts of axions. Now, for the last part of my talk, I will move from the lab to the sky, okay? And I will tell you how black holes can actually work as particle detectors. So, black holes have a characteristic size set by the horizon. Okay, and that size is, that length scale is anything between a kilometer and 10 to the 10 kilometers. And 1 kilometer is for the stellar mass black holes that are formed by the collapse of a star. And you get up to 10 to the 10 kilometers for black holes that are in the center of big galaxies, okay? And turns out that through a process called black hole superradiance, black holes can detect, can be the probe of bosons that have a similar Compton wavelength. Of course, this is interesting because now we know they're there. So, what is superradiance? And this is a cartoon just to explain to you what superradiance is. So first of all, superradiance is an effect that appears in many fields of physics. It's not just for gravity, it's not just for black holes. So how does it work? So you take a cylinder, imagine you have a cylinder that's rotating, and the surface of the cylinder is rough. Now you take a ball, and you scatter it tangentially from the cylinder. Okay? At first you do the experiment with the cylinder moving more slowly than the ball. And you see as the ball comes in at grazing incidence, the cylinder moves contrary to the motion of the ball, so there is friction and the ball slows down. Now let's speed up the cylinder. And let's make the velocity of the ball and the cylinder the same at the moment of impact. Then there is no loss of velocity at all. Nothing happens. You don't lose anything. Now let's speed up the cylinder even more. Now, if you speed up the cylinder even more and the cylinder starts moving faster than the ball, then when at the point of impact, the cylinder grabs onto the ball and just speeds it up. So, in fact, this is a process where friction actually gives energy to a system and it doesn't take it away. A similar thing can happen for waves. And there, the thing to compare is the velocity, the angular velocity of the cylinder with the angular velocity of the wave. So you get the same effect as with a ball. The wave gets amplified when the velocity of the cylinder is bigger than the velocity of the wave, is larger than the angular velocity of the wave. So this is what you see for the ball, and for a wave, when it scatters, you see that the amplitude grows. And as I said, this doesn't happen for gravity, it happens for a variety of systems. In fact, this first version of superradiance were worked out, the cylinder was a conducting cylinder and the wave was electromagnetic radiation. And this is what Zeldovich worked out in the early 70s. So, for black holes, the cylinder is the black hole itself, because astrophysical black holes are believed to be rotating. In fact, we measure them to be rotating. So they have a region around it called the ergo region. If they are rotating, where even light has to rotate. So this is what does the dragging. So now if you take a wave packet and you scatter it from a black hole, for certain properties of the wave packet can come out with higher amplitude than what it came in with. In 72, Pressel Tucholsky took this idea further and made a bomb. So now you take the same, you repeat the same experiment and you surround the black hole by a perfectly spherical mirror. Because the mirror is there, you have subsequent reflections of the wave, the amplitude gets amplified, the amplification is exponential, and eventually you get so much radiation pressure that the mirror explodes. Okay. So now the question is, why is this relevant for astrophysical black holes? We cannot go out there and build mirrors. The reason is because if you have now, so I was talking about electromagnetic radiation implicitly, and the photon is massless, so you cannot have the, once the you send the photon wave in, it just goes back to infinity. But if the boson has a mass, then you can create a bound state of the black hole, with a black hole. So the mass acts like a mirror that confines the particle, the boson, at the vicinity of the black hole, and this is what gives rise to exponential growth. So if you have a rotating black hole and a boson that has a similar Compton wavelength, what you will see happen, the black hole will spin down and you will see a cloud of particles populating a bound orbit around the black hole. And the black hole will spin down. This cloud of particles looks remarkably similar, like a hydrogen wave function, because the binding potential is just the 1/arc potential. So you can describe all its properties by defining a fine structure constant, which is just the Deutero constant, the mass of the black hole times the mass of the particle. You can define three quantum numbers. You have the principal quantum number, the orbital quantum number, and the magnetic quantum number. And you see that when you calculate the energy levels, you see that the energy binding energy of these states looks just like the Rydberg formula. Okay? Of course, there's a big difference in size, first of all. This is a kilometer, 10 to the 10 kilometer gravitational atom. Okay? You don't have fermions occupying the orbitals, you have bosons. So instead of just two, you can have 10 to the 77 or more. In fact, you can have more particles in this bound orbit than there are protons in all the stars of the universe. And the other difference is that also gives rise to this exponential growth is that now instead of having, when you solve for the hydrogen wave functions, you want them to be regular at the origin, but here at the origin you have, there is a horizon. So you have to put ingoing conditions at the horizon for the wave function, which makes the problem non-Hermitian. So you end up with something like that has real eigenvalues, like the hydrogen wave function. You find that you have your energy now has a small imaginary part, and this imaginary part can be positive. So in order for this imaginary part to be positive and have growth of the state, you have to satisfy what is called the superaddience condition, which is just a kinematic condition. It tells you that the frequency of the wave has to be less than the magnetic quantum number of the state times the angular velocity of the black hole. So this is just a condition that I said before. This omega over m is just the angular phase velocity of the wave. And omega is just the angular velocity of the cylinder. So you can think of this as some sort of superluminality condition. In fact, this effect of superaddience, again, is, as I said, is very general. Cherenkov radiation is what is called inertial motion superaddience. So Cherenkov radiation is just the same effect in linear motion instead of rotation. And for people that care about black hole dynamics, in fact, you can extract the same condition by requiring that the entropy of the black hole grows during this process. Okay, so the black hole emits particles and at the same time increases its entropy. So it's thermodynamically favorable. The next question is, how fast does it happen? And turns out that the time scale can be quite fast for scalars, for scalar particles, when a stellar mass black hole can be as fast as 100 seconds. This has to be compared with the accretion timescale for black holes, which is, for astrophysical black holes, is the Eddington accretion timescale, which is 10 to the 8 years. So for astrophysical black holes, this effect can occur, if the particle is in the right mass range, can occur in a rate that's able to affect the dynamics of the system. Okay. So, what is interesting for LIGO is gravitational wave emission. Because I'm talking about this gravitational atom in the sky, you can have several things. You can have transitions of particles between the different levels of the atom. And that gives rise to monochromatic gravitational wave radiation. What is more promising for advanced LIGO turns out, though, is another process. So if these bosons are their own antiparticle, you can have two particles from the cloud annihilate into a single graviton. Okay? So this produces monochromatic gravitational wave radiation that has energy of twice the rest energy of the particles. And you can see actually the signals can last for thousands and thousands of years for astrophysical black holes. And they appear at a relatively high frequency range for a particle that has a mass of 10 to the minus 11 eV. This is roughly, just to give you a quantum wavelength of something like a few tens of kilometers. And this is a plot that shows how well can advanced LIGO do. So this is the number, how many of these gravitational wave sources would you expect to see at advanced LIGO for a given mass of a boson, for a scalar particle. And you see this band here, the takeaway message, the solid lines are different upgrades of current and different upgrades of LIGO. And the point is that you see a large part of the solid blue line lies above one. So if you have particles in between roughly 10 to the minus 13 and 10 to the minus 12 eV in range, advanced LIGO can potentially look for them. Okay? So this is something that advanced LIGO, actually people at advanced LIGO can this is a search that can easily be done at advanced LIGO. So which brings us to the end. I could continue talking. There are several more ideas that I've had, that my colleagues have had, that have all happened, as I said before, in the last few years. But most importantly, I think in this game, because it's so new, there are many more ideas to be had. So if there are any young people out there that want to think about crazy things, this is the time to do it. Thank you.
Thanks for a really fascinating talk.
I'm still short. Maybe we'll have time for a quick one.
If you want to comment on the Bosanova piece and how fast would that occur across the region?
That we don't know. So this So what Derek is talking about is it's a process of when in this cloud I have ignored self-interactions. But self-interactions can become important. They can compete with the force of gravity and they can alter these dynamics of the cloud. And they can, in some cases, cause it to collapse in the same way that you see in labs, which is where you have a BEC, a Bose-Einstein condensate, and you switch the sign of the interaction. They've done this experiment, the trap BEC, and you turn it from repulsive to attractive, and you see the BEC collapse in the trap. And this is an explosion. Now, the answer is we don't know yet. So this is something that postdocs at Perimeter are working out right now. It may not be an explosion. In fact, it may be more of a slow release of particles. But in any case, what this will produce is, instead, in addition to gravitational waves, it will produce boson waves. So this would be things that will be kind of like streams of particles produced from these black holes that can be detected in dark matter detectors, for example, like the ones you know. but we don't know yet. We stay tuned. I'll let you know. Yeah.
Well, then I'll
yeah.
Any ideas on moduli that give an oscillation to the scale of Stoney-Crank?
Oh yes. So I didn't talk about, but I didn't show plot of it. But yes, they can. But it depends on what frequency you want to look at. So atomic clocks can look for those. So if you compare a hyperfine splitting with an optical splitting, you'll get sensitivity to the strong interaction because that changes the proton mass, basically, right? The bars wouldn't work for that, unfortunately. And maybe the molecules absorption in dark matter in molecules that we're thinking now would give signature. That would be at higher frequencies, much higher frequencies, at masses above 10 to the minus 3 eV. So yeah, there are ideas for that.
Okay, well, time is short, so I think we'll thank Mina for a really interesting.